That's the best job in the world.
I think my job is the best job in the world.
I flew in this electric plane, whose journey you could argue started in 1883. That was the first electric aircraft that ever flew, around 20 years before the Wright brothers. A long line of funny and useful e-aircrafts came after, including unmanned aerial vehicles, aka drones, and led the path to today.
Oh my God! This is the first certified plane to fly electric in the world. Right?
Yep.
Dozens of projects around the world are now figuring out how to finally make electric aviation a reality. And some honestly look downright funky. They're convinced the time has come. Some companies are already selling tickets. They're silent, cheap to operate, and potentially up to 90% more efficient than jet-fueled aircrafts. And e-planes are just
so cool!
But as you can see here, it's really easy to get caught up in all the hype. They've never really worked at scale before. So I'm in northeastern Sweden to find out,
why are we all not flying electric yet?
It won't surprise you to hear that how we fly today needs to change. Aviation makes up for around 3% of global emissions, and okay, that really doesn't sound so bad. But by 2050, that number is projected to rise to over 8 times that, and there are no real ways to fly pollution-free. So it is worrying. One of the most promising solutions to aviation pollution are biofuels, or more broadly, sustainable aviation fuels. They're mostly made from non-petroleum products like biomass or algae. You can basically just swap the fossil fuels in here for biofuels, or make a blend. But we need so much of it that scaling up is very hard. And the land could be used for other purposes like growing food or saving forests. And then there's also hydrogen that's showing promise, especially hydrogen made sustainably, and a lot of prototypes are being tested. Electric planes are a third option, and they can make a really compelling case.
Up here where we live, we run off hydropower or wind power, so the electricity we have is sustainable and renewable. So of course that's the most sustainable we can do right now for us.
This is Johan Norberg, a scholar of aviation and one of the only people flying e-planes every day. We're at an aviation school in Sweden, where future pilots are being trained in flying electric planes.
We want to sort of lead the industry into something new and show that it's possible to train new pilots with high quality and but in a sustainable way.
I mean, you sound quite confident that it's going to happen.
I mean, I feel confident in a way that I'm an electrical engineer as well. One major difference compared to maybe 10 years ago is that there's proper money being put into.
That's because if we get electric engines right, we'll win the efficiency game. Electric engines can be 3 times more efficient than those that use fossil fuels. And of course, they don't degrade the air quality during operation. The pipistrel Velis they fly here doesn't need much electricity. It takes around 1.5 hours to charge, on which it can fly 45 minutes with a reserve of 30% battery. It's mostly used for pilot training or privately. Skellefteå Airport has a 1 megawatt charging station, which is enough to charge a small fleet of electric planes at the same time.
It's like a bathtub to get in, so ass first is easiest. Yep.
I'm ready.
All right, let's go.
This is a super light plane, but it can only carry 2 people with no hand luggage. To go any bigger, e-planes are faced with a big problem. Heavy batteries. Even though there have been a lot of advancements in batteries, we actually haven't come that far. We've crossed the threshold for cars, roughly for an electric Chevrolet Bolt to drive the distance a Honda Civic could on a full tank of fuel, the battery would need to be 17 times heavier. And cars just stay on the ground, so the weight doesn't matter so much. But for a Boeing 747 to fly from, say, London to Istanbul, batteries will need to be this much heavier than a full tank. This just can't work, since this would be 10 times heavier than the heaviest payload ever lifted.
When you're storing energy, you need a very high level of energy density.
That's Scott Carey, head of the airports program at the U.S. Department of Energy's National Renewable Energy Lab.
And petroleum and petroleum-related products, or petroleum-derived products like biofuels, have a really high energy density.
When compared to the energy density of traditional fuel, batteries fare very poorly, coming in at only 2%. But conventional aircrafts we fly in today are built for jet fuel. It all started with a design off in the 1950s between propeller planes that were more popular at the time and turbine engines like this.
The performance characteristics between those two aircraft were the turbine was slightly faster, but it couldn't go as far. And, you know, you got marginal gains by doing it. And then 5 years later, they figured out for different sizes, for different configurations, all of a sudden it makes sense to use these because of, you know, how light you can make those turbines.
Over time, this turbine or tube and wing design became vastly more efficient, a clear winner of the race. Today's jetliners burn almost 50% less fuel per passenger kilometer than they did 50 years ago, with the help of better engines, improved aerodynamics, and a lot of other often invisible changes. But the thing is, this design has peaked in a way. It's very hard to become more carbon efficient unless you squeeze even more people onto already very tight planes. So governments and many in the industry are going back to the drawing board to redesign in another 1950s style design off.
It's a really, really interesting time in that sense, because things are up for grabs again.
This is Tom Budd, an aviation expert who looks at on-the-ground infrastructure to support the transition by working together with Heathrow Airport.
We looked at two main modes of operation for doing that. One, which was a battery charging system, so where the battery would remain fixed within the aircraft. You would plug it in as if you would like a normal device. You would just, you know, charge it.
This would be the simplest way, operationally speaking. But they also found that charging would waste precious time when current air traffic relies on a quick turnaround. Planes would occupy limited space in the airport. And of course, the amount of power needed would take away significantly from the city's grid.
The second sort of mode of operation that we looked at was a battery swapping system. And that would be where you would have pre-charged batteries. And then when an aircraft came in, you would remove the battery from the airframe and then swap it with one that had already been pre-charged.
This would save space and time, but would require a lot of specialization, which we currently don't have anywhere. And it would be a big risk. Meddling with an airframe is always dangerous. And there's also the major risk of fires from holding so many batteries in one place.
So of the two systems, we favored the battery charging system, but we were very aware of the potential limitations that that could pose.
So not easy.
Oh my God!
Yeah, I mean, you can fly if you want.
No, what do I do?
Ah! Oh, if you want the nose to go down, then you push the stick forward. If you want to.
No, please take it back. Wow, that was too much power. I can't handle that.
Pipistrels were the first planes to be certified. But this is another huge challenge that aviation has compared to cars, being certified for safety. So everything takes time for R&D, testing, including for battery safety and the years-long certification process. But this January, the European Parliament pushed for the idea of more e-planes for short and mid-range flights. This is part of a wider goal to cut 90% of emissions from transport by 2050.
All right.
Thank you. That was great.
The company that made the Pipistrel is now working on a four-seater plane. And there are already bigger ones. A plane called Alice that could carry 9 passengers and 2 crew members seems to be close to commercialization, promising to fly around 400 kilometers. Heart Aerospace in Sweden has a proof-of-concept aircraft that could fly 25 passengers up to 800 kilometers by 2026.
When you look at, if you think about, there are existing cargo routes that use small aircraft. There are existing communities that their only connection is a 9-seat aircraft, unless they take a ferry for 4 or 6 hours type of a situation. Those are real existing routes that have to be either subsidized or paid for by communities.
This is the main application so far, and it is significant. In 2020, the US spent $326 million to subsidize the costs of aircrafts to smaller airports that don't see a profit. Air ambulances, air taxis, and small cargo planes also need only small aircrafts. DHL has ordered 12 planes for low emissions postal deliveries, which can help local noise and air quality too. But let's put this all in perspective. With everything that electrification can do now, based on current battery tech and operational challenges, a study by the International Center on Clean Aviation estimates that electric aircraft could cover 9% of the commuter market. That's flights with more than 19 passengers and distances shorter than 500 kilometers. But this only accounts for 0.002% of global aviation. By 2050, they estimate it could be up to 0.2%. Which is still small when we're talking about carbon emissions. But this is purely electric we're talking about.
You could also have versions of hybrid. So you could have a series hybrid, which is where essentially fuel is used to power an electric motor, which then powers the aircraft. So you're using fuel to charge a battery, essentially. And then you also have what are called parallel hybrids, which is where you have the electric motor and the fuel source, so kerosene or hydrogen, both being used for propulsion.
I can't imagine this tiny plane getting much bigger in the next few years, but the hybrid argument really makes sense. The IATA estimates that hybrids will be the next leap in aviation in the 2030s, with new designs replacing the tube and wing, and this will contribute to a 40% reduction in emissions by 2050. Longer flights will most likely use biofuels, with some parts of the plane electrified and some use of hydrogen. The pipistrel is a small step, but it gives hope for the potential of the diversity of technologies that we're going to need.
So what do you think of this cute little plane and the future of planes like this? Let us know in the comment section below and come back every Friday for more videos.